So good morning students. So today I will explain you about the semiconductor memories. Okay, semiconductor memories. So semiconductor memories, those are divided into two types. Those are nothing but program memory and data memory. Okay, so these semiconductor memories, okay, are divided into two parts. So one is program memory and next one is data memory. Okay, so what is program memory? Program memory is nothing but whatever the instructions stored in the memory. Okay, so that will be whatever the instructions are there, that will be stored in the program memory. Okay, so program memory means instruction set. Suppose we know that group of instruction sets is nothing but a program. So in order to write a program, you need some instructions. So these instruction sets will be stored in the program memory. Program memory. Okay. And data memory. So data memory is nothing but whatever the data is there. So whatever the data you want to process, so that will be stored in the data memory. Okay. So data. Whatever the data is there, data stored in data memory. Okay, so data will be stored in data memory. So you can note down, program memory is nothing but the set of instructions on which that means in order to process this memory, you need either a microprocessor or a microcomputer in order to interface with these memories. Okay, so the program memory is nothing but the set of instructions on which a microprocessor operates are stored. Okay, so whatever the instructions will be there, that will be stored in the program memory. Okay, next, data memory. So this is a program memory, the set of instructions on which a microprocessor operates are stored in program memory. Okay, next, data memory, the data which the program uses is stored in data memory. Okay, the data in which, so whatever the data you want to process, so the data which the program uses is stored in the data memory. Okay, so that means we can also call this program memory as ROM, okay, and data memory as read write memory, or we can call as a RAM, read write memory, or we can call as a RAM. So before going into the memory types of memories in ROM and RAM, so first of all I want to say about the organization. Okay, memory organization. So these are the locations. Okay, suppose here these 1 2 3 4 5 6 7, these are nothing but we call it a locations. Okay, locations in the memory. And next, these are nothing but these column wise we call as data. We call as data. Okay, so data bits. So that means here, so this memory is nothing but it have total 7 locations and 5 bits of data will be there. So this type of memory we call as a 7x5 memory. Okay, so that means we can say this memory with an example. Suppose in your colony that there are so many houses. Okay, so where is your house means how you can say that means in for your house there will be some address. Okay, so in that address you are there. Okay, so that means suppose if you got any post like that, so postman will go to that colony and search for the house and he will give the whatever the letter to you. Okay, so that means in order to access whatever the data from the memory location, so what you need to do first, the micro processor or a micro computer or micro controller, so what it will do, it will first search for the address location. Okay, so this is nothing but the address location. Each and every part of memory has a specific address. Okay, so in this address location some data will be there. Okay, so it will so that means the microprocessor can read the data or write the data. Okay, it can read the data or it can write some data into this memory. Okay, so that means so this 5 bits are nothing but this is nothing but a 5 bit buffer. We call it a buffer register. So we already seen the shift registers. Okay, so these are mainly made up of with parallel in parallel out shift register. Parallel in parallel shift registers means, so whatever the data coming parallelly, that will taken out parallel out. Okay, so mainly we are constructing this shift registers by using which one? D flip flop. Okay, so applying clock to this D flip flop. Okay, so each cell, suppose this one is made with one D flip flop. Total 5 locations are there. So that means 5 locations are made with 5 D flip flop. Okay, so here you can say that, so you have 7 locations. You have 7 locations. On each location, we can store how many bits? 5 bits of data. So total in this memory location, you have 7 locations. In these 7 locations, you can store how many bits of data? So that means data length is how much? 5 bits of data. Okay, so suppose n bit memory is there, so let us take n bit memory. Okay, n bit memory, so if you take the n bit memory, so how many, so if it is a n bits, so total n bits, how many combinations? 2 power n combinations will be there. 2 power n combinations will be there. Okay, so that means if it is n address, so that means n address bit is there. So that means you have 2 power n address, total address lines will be there. Okay, suppose n equal to 4, if you see, so that means 2 power 4, so total how many address lines are there? 2 power 4 means 16 address lines will be there. Okay, so like this. Okay, so that means 2 power n address, or we can call this as a 2 power n locations. If it is a n bit, you have 2 power n locations. So in general, we can represent the size of the memory like this. So 2 power n cross n. Okay, so where n is nothing but address at the number of address lines. Okay, n is nothing but number of address lines, and n is nothing but number of data lines. Okay, so this is how, this is nothing but we can call as a size of the memory. Okay, so like this we can define the memory. Okay, so in general this is the size of the memory. Okay, so so whatever the data is there, data will be stored in the location. Okay, so that is word means, suppose if you consider like 4 bits, so word can be, so whatever the data is there, data stored in each location. So that means each location means it can be stored in word. So the word can be 4 bit to 16. So 4 bit to 64 bit. Okay, 4 bit to 64 bit. Okay, so that means so you have the processors like 32 bit processor or 64 bit processor. Some controllers are there. That is 8 bit processor. So that means why we call that as a 32 bit or 64 bit or 8 bit means it can process at a time that many bits. So if it is a 32 bit processor, it will process 32 bit of data. If it is a 64 bit, it will process 64 bit of data at a time. Okay. So if it is a 8 bit means all the registers in that are of either 32 bit or 64 bit. Suppose for the 8 bit, if you are giving a 16 bit data, it will take 288 bits. Okay. So that's why we call as a what is your processor bit length means you can say that mostly 64 bit, 128 bit or 32 bit like that. Okay. So next, if you see group of 4 bits is nothing but nibble. This is nothing but nibble. Okay. Group of 8 bits is nothing but 1 byte. You need to know about this. And a group of 16 bits is nothing but half word. And a group of 32 bits is nothing but word. You need to know about this terminology. Okay, group of 4 bits is nothing but nibble. Group of 8 bits is 1 byte. Byte, we can call this as a byte. Okay, group of 16 bits is nothing but half word. Group of 32 bits is nothing but word. Okay, so let us take byte is there. It is represented as capital B. So this is nothing but bytes. If it is bits means it is represented as small b. Okay, there is a difference between capital B and small b. Suppose what is your internet speed? So that means they can say that it can be in kbps and it can be mbps. So that means b means here bits. So that means the data, the speed of the data is in terms of bits per second. Okay, not bytes per second. So that is nothing but bits per second. Okay, so in general you can have the block diagram for the memory. So for the memory you have data lines and you have the address lines. Okay, so if you say this is a memory, so you have the address. So here you have the address A0, A1, A2, A3 and A4. Okay, so these are nothing but the address lines. Address lines. Okay, you know that this memory is nothing but parallel in parallel out. So whatever the data coming parallelly. Okay, so this is nothing but these are the data D0, D1, D2, D3. Okay, so these are the data pins. Okay, these are data inputs. Okay, and these are the data outputs. Okay, so D0, D1, D2 and D3. So these are nothing but data outputs. Okay, and for the memory you have a chip select. So that is nothing but enable. Okay, so why we need this chip select means, suppose like so many memories are there, like ROM is there, RAM is there, data RAM is there, data ROM is there. So whatever our microprocessor or a microcontroller, it want to interface, it can interface only one memory at a time. Okay, so that means so what it will do, it will give a chip select to the memory, that it will select a particular memory, X memory. It will select the X memory. So then based on the chip select, it will connect to the particular memory. So there in that situation we can use this enable pin as a chip select. Okay, this is nothing but we call as a chip select. Okay, and next you have a pin called R by W bar. R by W bar is nothing but read by write bar. So read by write bar means whatever the microprocessor or a microcontroller is there, that can read the data from the memory or it can write the data into the memory. Okay, so That means when read by write bar equal to 1, okay, so microcontroller or microprocessor will read the data, okay, read the data from the memory, okay, read the data from the memory, okay. Suppose read by write bar, so this is R is nothing but active low, active high signal. So that means this will be activated when R by W bar equal to 1. W bar is nothing but active low signal. So this will be activated when W bar equal to what? R by W bar equal to 0. So that means write operation. It will do the write operation. Write the data. So microprocessor or microcontroller. Okay. So write the data into the memory. It can write the data into the memory. Okay, so suppose let us take total you have 5 address lines. Okay, so 5 address lines are there. Address inputs will be there. Okay, so total that means what is how many memory locations it can access? The microprocessor can access 2^5 address lines. Okay, address input is 5, so that means 2^5 addresses. So that means 2^5 means total how many locations it can access? Total 32 locations. Okay, so each location is of let us take 4 bit. Okay, so here in the diagram, so total you have 5 address inputs. Okay, so that means total you have 2^5 address locations will be there. Okay, so each location, how many data lines will be there? 4 bits. So data lines are 4 bits. Each location have how many data bits? 4 bits. Okay, so 4 bits. So that means what is the memory size? So memory size can be represented as in general 2^n×n. Okay, so that means here what is n? 5, and capital N equal to what? 4. Okay, so that means 2^5×4. So that means 32 cross 4. So this is the size of the memory. This is the actual size of the memory. So like this, depending on the number of data lines, okay, depending on the number of address, number of data lines and number of address lines, you can specify the size of the memory. Okay, so next you have memory. So if you see the memory, so there are 2 operations will be there. As I told you, one is read operation and next one is write operation. Okay, so what is read operation? As I told you, when read by write bar equal to 0, okay, first of all we'll see 1. Okay, equal to 1. So what is that operation? That is memory read. When read by write bar equal to 0, so this is nothing but memory read and memory write. Okay, so next, how this microprocessor or microcontroller will communicate first of all to the memory. So that means in order to operate this memory, you need some processing device in order to interface with this memory. Okay, so here you have one microprocessor. This is one microprocessor. So this is some processing device. Okay, so this is microprocessor, and here you have a memory. Here you have the memory. Okay, so the microprocessor will interface with the memory. Okay, so first of all, what the microprocessor will do? It will connect to the memory. First it will find the address. Okay, so let us take this is a 8085 processor. Okay, so 8085 means it is having 16 address lines. Okay, so total it have 16 address lines. Okay, at 16 address lines are represented with a thick arrow. Okay, why? Because this bus we call as 16 bit address bus. Okay, so it is communicating with this memory, and it is accessing the 16-bit address in this memory. Okay, so again, each memory have 8-bit of data. So each memory is having the 8-bit of data. So this is a 8-bit of data. 8-bit of data. So here you need to observe that this this arrow. So this is unidirectional. So the address bus is unidirectional. That means microprocessor can give find the address from the memory. Okay, memory cannot find the address from address into the microprocessor. So that's why this is a 16-bit address bus. Okay, and if you see the data bus, this is nothing but bidirectional. So why it is bidirectional means microprocessor can read the data from the memory. Okay, it can read the data from the memory. So that means it can read the data from the memory. Okay, so it can read the data from the memory, or microprocessor can write the data into the memory. Okay, so that means read operation and write operation will be done in the data bus. So that's why it is a bidirectional data bus. Okay, so next you have chip select. So that is nothing but enable pin. You have a chip select in order to, so if so many memories are there, so microprocessor can communicate with only one memory. So it need to select a particular memory, that particular memory. So for that you need a chip select. So that is nothing but enable. Okay, enable is nothing but chip select. And for reading and writing operation, okay, so you have, so microprocessor can read the data from the memory or write the data into the memory. So that means you have read by write bar. Okay, so this is the basic interfacing of a microprocessor with the memory. Okay, so you need to remember that address bus is unidirectional. Okay, so address bus is unidirectional. So address bus is unidirectional, and data bus is bidirectional. Okay, address bus is unidirectional and data bus is bidirectional. Okay, so please note down some two points. A bus is a group of signals or lines. A bus is a group of signals or lines performing the same function. Performing the same function. As I told you, so what is a bus? Bus is nothing but a group of signals. Group of signals we can call as a line. So here, so in order to indicate all the 16 bits of address bus, so I indicated one arrow. Okay, with thick arrow, that is nothing but 16-bit address bus. Okay. And here the data bus is bidirectional. The data bus is bidirectional because during read operation, data is transferred from memory to microprocessor. Data is transferred from memory to microprocessor. This operation, and during the write operation, data is transferred from microprocessor to memory. Okay, so that means data is bidirectional means during the read operation, so whatever the data present in the memory, that will be transferred from memory to the microprocessor, and during the write operation, so there will be some data in the microprocessor that will be transferred from microprocessor to the memory. Okay, so that's why the data bus is bidirectional. Okay, suppose we'll see how to access this memory. Okay, so we'll see. So we'll see one example, like access data. Stored at 00AH, okay, and add 1 to it. Okay, so that means microprocessor should access the data present in the address location 000AH. Okay, after accessing the data present in this address location, it need to add 1 to this. So that means there is a memory location. So in this, these are the memory locations. In this, this is the address. Okay, so let us consider in this some data is there, 8 bit data is there, 1 2 is there. So for 1 2, what you need to do, it should add. So 1 2 plus 1 means that is nothing but 1 3. Okay, next what you need to do, so 1 3 you got. Okay, again it, so add 1 to it and store. Okay, so store the result, whatever the result is there, at 000BH. Okay, so that means you got 13H. So 13H should be stored in which location? 000BH. Okay, so first you need to access this memory microprocessor. Some value is there, 12 is there. For 12, it need to add 1. It should perform the addition operation. After adding, what you need to do, it should store that result in the 00BH location. Okay, so this operation it need to perform. Okay, so this operation I will explain you. So first, what operation it will do? Okay, so first, what the microprocessor will do? First, microprocessor will place the address 00AH on address bus. Okay, so whatever our microprocessor is there, place the address, place the address that is 00AH on address bus. On address bus, first it will place the address in the address bus. Okay, and next enable pin, so that is nothing but chip select, it should make as 1. Okay, and next read by write bar. Okay, so read by write bar equal to what? 1. Why it is 1? First means it will place the address in that address bus. Microprocessor need to read whatever that value, what is the value present in this address location. So for that, read by write bar equal to what? 1. It should read the data present in that address location. Okay, so after that, after read operation, memory places the data at 00AH. Memory places the data at 00AH. Okay, on data bus. Okay, on data bus. Suppose example, same example I can take, like 12H is there. 12H is there. Okay, so now now what you need to do, microprocessor. So microprocessor, so it should add. Okay, so it should add, microprocessor add 1 to 12H. So what is the result you are getting? Add 1 to 12H, what is the result you are getting? 13H. You are getting 13H. Okay, now next, so it should do the add operation. After adding of add operation, now microprocessor places the address 00BH. So whatever the result you are getting, that should be stored in the next location, that is 00BH. Okay, so 00BH on address bus and 13H is there. This is nothing but data on data bus. So whatever the next address is there, that will be kept on the address bus, that is 00BH, and 13H is there, so that is the data, so that is keeping on the data bus. Okay, so now next, what you need to do, next operation, chip select, it is making as 1, and read by write bar equal to what? 0. So here read by write bar equal to 1 means it is doing the read operation. So that means it is checking what value present in that address location. Okay, so So here the read by write bar equal to 0 means it is doing write operation. So write operation means after performing the calculations, whatever the processing, that means it is adding one to the data. Okay. So after adding one to that data, so whatever the result you are getting, okay, whatever the result the microprocessor is getting, it is writing into that memory. Okay. So that means this is write operation. Now you can write. So that is 13H gets stored at 000BH. 000BH. Okay. So like this we can do the memory operation. Okay. So this is the basic operation of the memory. Okay. So that means here I can say one example, like Microsoft Word is there. So Word means suppose if you are opening the Word in the computer or a laptop, so what you are doing, that Word file is there, that will be stored in the hard disk. Okay. So when you are opening that, that means internally there will be a processor. Processor will read that Word. Okay, read that Word, and that means you can open that Word. Okay. Suppose any changes you are making in that Word. So any changes you are making in that Word, after making some after entering some data, you need to save that data. Okay, you need to save that Word. So after saving, so that means when you are saving, so what the processor is doing, whatever the saved data is there, so the saved data will be again write into that memory. So that means again it will be write into that hard disk. Okay, this is one example how the microprocessor is accessing the data present in the hard disk like that. Okay, so this is about the operation of the memory. Next, so types of memory, if you see, so as I already told, that is program memory and data memory. No, okay, so types of memory, you have two types. So that is program memory. So we call as read-only memory, that is ROM, and read and write memory. So that means this is nothing but RWM, or we can call as a random access memory. RAM is nothing but random access memory. Okay, so these are mainly these ROMs are based on the programmable logic devices. Okay, so programmable logic, the PLDs, we call it the PLDs. Basically you have a PLA, PAL, programmable logic array, and programmable array logic. So this I will explain you in the coming classes. Okay, so in this class I will concentrate on RAM. Okay, so RAM is nothing but random access memory. So why this the examples for the RAM is nothing but we can call it a pen drive or hard disk. Okay, so that means we can read or write the memory into this RAM. Okay, so pen drive means you can save so many songs or movies in the pen drive, or suppose if you can save your documents, whatever the documents in the pen drive. Okay, hard disk you already know. So you suppose if you have the mobile phone, so mobile phone means how much of hard disk, means you have one means your laptop hard disk is 1 terabyte. Okay, and your mobile phone nowadays you are getting 128 bytes of internal memory. That is nothing but same thing. So whatever the data is there, you can store in that read-write memory. And in ROM, we call as a CDs. Okay, in olden days there are CDs. Okay, so CDs we call, that means we can access the memory. Suppose in some last 10 years there will be CDs. So if you want to watch a movie, what you need to do, you need to go to the CD shop and you need to take the whatever the movie CD movie is there for the rent. And you can watch that movie. After watching, you can return to that CD shop. Okay, So that those are nothing but CD, and you have like tape recorders are there. Tape recorders. So tape recorders means you have like so the tape recorder will be like this. So there will be a magnetic ribbon over here. Okay. So the magnetic ribbon. So in this there is a magnetic strip. So it will read whatever the data sequentially. So that means initially in the last 10 years back they used this tape recorder in order to play a song. Okay. So those comes under the read only memory. Okay. Read only memory. So that means so that means this CDs will comes under read write memory only. But in this read write memory there are two types. Okay, so those are nothing but sequential memory and random access memory. Okay, so sequential memory means what? We can access in sequence so we can access the data in a sequence. Okay, sequence means we can access the data in sequence. Okay, in sequence so that means accessing different locations is not possible. Example, like CDs. Okay, hard disk is nothing but multiple CDs. Okay, so there will be a multiple CDs will be there, and magnetic tape, this comes under the sequential memory. Okay, read write memory. And random access memory means we can access every location. That means we can access any location. Okay, concurrently. Okay, so we can access time for every location is same. So for random access memory, the access time for every location is same, but for the sequential memory, the access time is a different. Okay, so access time for every location is different. Okay, different. Okay, every location is different. So we can access the data sequentially. Okay, so these are the two types of memory. So one is sequential memory and random access memory. So in this in sequential memory we can't access the random data. Okay, so random data we can't access. So that means sequentially it will go. Suppose magnetic tape is there, sequentially the songs will come. So you can forward or reverse. Okay, but sequentially you can't skip from one song to the fifth song like that. So sequentially it will come. A CD is also sequential. Okay, sequential memory. And random access memory means you can access the data random. Okay, in random. Okay, so you can note down, RAM is used for temporary storage of program and data. Okay, RAM is used for temporary storage of program and data. During runtime, all applications and programs make use of RAM. So that means during runtime. So where you are using this RAM? During runtime. That means when you are opening any application. Okay, when you are opening, suppose WhatsApp is there. WhatsApp. When you are opening the WhatsApp, the RAM will come into picture. That means temporary storage data will be stored in the RAM. So whatever the temporary data is there, that will be stored in the RAM. Okay, and RAM is volatile. RAM is volatile means what? So whenever there is a power loss, whatever the data present in the RAM, that will be so what that will be erased. Okay, so whatever the data is there, that will be erased. Okay, RAM is volatile, which means the data stored vanishes. RAM is volatile, which means the data stored vanishes when the power is switched off. So RAM is volatile when the which means the data is stored vanishes. So that means when the power is switched off. Okay, so we'll see the different types of RAM. Okay, different types of RAM. There are static RAM and dynamic RAM in the coming class.